Hi. In this video, I'm going to introduce you to serialization. Serialization is the process of converting an object into a stream. Deserialization is the process of reconstructing an object that has been serialized before. Let's look at this image here. We have an object. We are converting the object to a stream of bytes, and once we have a stream of bytes, we can store that, for example, in a database or in memory or on file. Deserialization is the opposite process. I take the data that I stored in a file, in a database, etc., read it as a sequence of bytes, and reconstruct the object based on the sequence of bytes that I read. Why do we serialize? There are a couple good reasons. One of them is to store data or the state of an object. Objects are created on the heap, and the heap is for temporary storage. When my application terminates, the object is no longer accessible. If I want to keep the state of my object, if I want to keep the data stored in my objects, then I can serialize them and persist them, let's say, in a file, in a database, and access them long after my application has terminated. Another good reason to serialize is to transmit data or the state of an object. At this point, we are not so concerned about keeping data or state for a longer time, but about making it available in a different location. So when we convert an object to a series of bytes, we can transmit it over a network and then reconstruct it in a different place. A third reason to serialize is to clone an object without overriding clone. Let's look at the scenario where we have an object and we serialize it and store it in a file. To store a serialized object in a file, we create an object output stream with a file output stream passed as an argument. Let's look at the difference between a file output stream and an object output stream. A file output stream writes binary data to a file. That means it takes a sequence of bytes and writes it to a file. An object output stream converts a Java object or a primitive type to a sequence of bytes and writes it to an output stream. Now, where this output stream ends up is undefined at this point. Could be a file output stream, could be a byte array output stream, etc. Object output streams take objects and convert them to a sequence of bytes. Let's look at the same scenario from the perspective of a code segment. So here I have the new operator and the constructor of the object output stream, and we pass as an argument a new file output stream based on a given file. The object output stream converts the object to a sequence of bytes. The file output stream stores the sequence of bytes to a file, to this file that was specified right here. When using wrapped streams, closing the outmost stream also closes the underlying file. Caveat: opening an existing file overwrites that file. So this is something we want to be conscious about. Now let's look at the opposite process. We're deserializing. At this point, we want to read from the file where we serialized the object before and recreate the object based on the data that was stored in that file. To recreate an object from a file, we create an object input stream with the file input stream passed as an argument. Let's look at the difference between a file input stream and an object input stream. A file input stream reads binary data from a file. In other words, it knows how to open a file, read data, and turns it into a stream of bytes. An object input stream reads a sequence of bytes from an input stream and reconstructs a Java object or a primitive type based on that data. In other words, the object input stream takes a sequence of bytes and transforms it to an object. Here we have a constructor call, ObjectInputStream, and as an argument we pass a file input stream. Now when we create a new file input stream, we pass as an argument a path to a file. In this case, it is a relative path. First, the file input stream is created and the relative path is passed as an argument. So the file input stream knows how to open a file and transforms it to a sequence of bytes. Then the object input stream is created and we pass the file input stream with its capability to open a file and transform the data to a stream of bytes to the object input stream. The object input stream takes the sequence of bytes, transforms it to an object. So for the object input stream, it doesn't really matter where the sequence of bytes came from. In our case, it was a file input stream. It originated at a file, but it could have also come from a network or some other place. For the file input stream, it doesn't really matter where the sequence of bytes go to, whether I just print them on a screen, whether I pass them on to the object input stream so an object can be recreated, etc. Once again, the file input stream opens a file, creates a sequence of bytes based on the data in the file. The object input stream takes the sequence of bytes, recreates the object based on the sequence of bytes. Object input stream has a method called readObject. It also has a variety of other read methods like readInt, readLong, readDouble for primitive types. They take the byte stream and use it to create either a primitive type, in case of read object, to recreate an object. Before we have a look at a code example, I want to introduce you to the interface serializable. If a class wants to have its state serialized or deserialized, it needs to implement the interface serializable. When you have a look at the members of the interface serializable, you'll realize that there are none. No methods, no fields. The interface serializable has the only purpose to identify a class as serializable. If a class implements the interface serializable, every instance field has to be serializable or declared as transient. Transient means that this instance field will be ignored during serialization. All primitive type variables are serializable.